morning. May the word of God be heard in this place. May all the other words blow away like so much chaff on the wind. Amen. The first time I walked into 61st Avenue, United Methodist Church, it was a hot day, late August, and I had to look around for a while before I found anyone in the building. Nested in between a vacant lot and a plastics factory, the church itself was a single-story cinder block structure, painted white, with two main wings, a classroom, an office hallway, and then a sanctuary. At the back, there was a fellowship hall and kitchen that connected the two. It was my first day on the job as a part-time associate pastor, and I had no idea what to expect. I wound my way back, all the way to the fellowship hall. It was a room full of banquet tables and chairs with a pass-through window to the kitchen. And lo, to my great relief, the lights were on in the kitchen. Someone was banging around me. It was Miss Brenda Hicks. Brenda Hicks, the lay leader of the church, van driver, office manager, former employee of the defunct mattress factory up the road, and one of the holiest saints of my life. I introduced myself a little awkwardly, and Brenda just beamed at me. She just beamed at me. She said, "Oh, hi, honey. I'm so glad you're here. You want a bologna sandwich?" Now, a bologna sandwich on white bread was the last thing that I wanted when I walked in the door. But on that day, with Miss Brenda, it tasted just about like Holy Communion. And it was the first of many bologna sandwiches I'd share with the saints of that church. About half a dozen women gathered there once a week for an evening Bible study. Now, it was intentionally and exclusively female space. Since I qualified in that regard, and the other pastor didn't, I got to staff the Bible study, which was fine, most of the time. They really led it themselves in the conversations that centered more on life than on scripture. And so no one really expected much from me in terms of leadership. That was a good thing for me, since my life was just getting busier and more complicated by the day. You see, I was still in the divinity school. And for some reason, I don't know why, for some reason, I thought it was a good idea to take a full course load, plus a couple of audits for fun, and then work, you know, three jobs on top of that, because why not? I had a lot of energy back then. I don't know where it went, but I did. Now, someplace right about the middle of that semester, things got even more complicated, because I picked up a serious boyfriend named Ben Coleman. I didn't have an inch or an hour to spare, but I really liked him. And so I tried to make it all fit. Something had to give, and it did. I confess that I started to resent that evening Bible study. I don't know if you've ever felt like this, maybe you have, but I felt trapped by that commitment. The meetings would wander all over the place. People just wanted to share their feelings, you know, and to talk about life and gossip a little bit and talk over church politics and that kind of stuff. And all I wanted to do was go home or be somewhere else, finishing a paper, seeing my boyfriend, washing up the dishes, piling the sink, anywhere but in that meeting. I felt dry and brittle stretched farther than I can stretch. I keep thinking about that feeling. That dry, stretched, too thin feeling. When this year's stewardship campaign comes up. Now maybe you've noticed it's stewardship season around here. Did you notice? If you've seen the promotional materials, which you probably got on your way to work, you know the theme is T-cubed, which stands for time, talent, and treasure. All three things we're invited to give more of. And frankly, friends, these are three things that seem to be in shorter and shorter supply, at least for me. Time especially, but treasure too, sometimes talent. Everywhere I go, someone wants me to sign up for something, you know? The first grade fall party, preschool trunk or treat, a community board meeting, a committee, a fundraiser, another fundraiser. And while it's nice to be needed, it's nice to be needed, I wonder sometimes, who decided that all our time ought to be scheduled so tightly? And I wonder, who wins the prize in this frantic, hectic race? I know it's not me, that's for sure. And back in the old days, when the story we hear about Elijah was written, I think they had something similar going on. I think they did. See, but when they felt dry and brittle and stretched too thin, they reached out for whatever promised to ease the pain, bring the rain. In Elijah's day, that meant a god called Baal. And Baal promised to bring the rain in its season, to make big harvests just spring out of the ground, and to keep the flocks fat and abundant. And maybe it worked for a while, for some people. But in the end, the drought comes in. The drought always comes. We get sick. People we love get sick. Our relations start to fray, fall apart sometimes. We forget who we are and to whom we belong. That's what Elijah kept trying to tell everyone. He kept telling anyone who was. He told the king, told King Ahab. Baal can't actually deliver all that stuff. He promises. But no one listened to Elijah. No one wanted to hear that. They were too caught up in the frantic, hectic race to listen. So when the rain dried up, the crops started to fail, everyone was surprised, except Elijah. And so the God we know sent him out into the wilderness, out to a creek bed. A creek bed, that's what a wadi is, a creek bed, with a little bit of water still flowing in. And the way the story is told, the ravens brought him meat and bread to eat, way out on the edge of everything with the scavengers. Elijah found shelter from the drought, and he survived. He did. And those of us who spent some time in the wilderness, well, we know how it is out there. Nothing is certain. The rules are all suspended, and we wait. We wait for the next day to come, hoping that we'll be there to see it, waiting for the test results to come back, praying that our children are safe, the market recovers, that the promotion comes through, that the word doesn't get out. The wilderness is rough terrain. It's rough. And even so, the wilderness is the place where God speaks most clearly. and where we hear, but we refuse to hear otherwise. It does its work. It does. And in that dry season, the wilderness did its work on Elijah. He heard God speaking even as the creek bed was going dry. God called Elijah even farther out from the people and the places he knew. God called Elijah to a place called Zarephath in Sidon, and to a woman who knew the wilderness even better than he did. God promised that she had something for him to eat. I don't know. I don't know if he would have gone if he hadn't been so hungry. Because the people at Sidon weren't Elijah's kind of people. See, they didn't drive his kind of car, live in his kind of house. But God said, go. Elijah was hungry. So he went. When he found her, she was on the brink of starving too. She and her son had one meal left. One meal left. And Elijah told her about his own hunger, and about the God who sent him to her. And even though her need was bigger than his, she trusted Elijah's God. Her need recognized his need. She had compassion for him, and so she shared what little she had left. And that gift opened up a channel for God's promise to come to life. And friends, the way the story is told, through the cup of grain and the measure of oil, she and Elijah and her son, well, they all ate for many days. I don't know if I would have gone to Bible study that night if I hadn't been on autopilot. I felt overwhelmed and exhausted and broke and sick with grief. You see, someone I loved had been living with cancer for years, but it looked like the end was finally in sight. 18 months at the outside, the doctor said. If things went well, they said, we'd have a little more than a year together. I was in the wilderness. I was in the wilderness. And the creek was starting to run dry. But I showed up for the women's Bible study because it was my job to be there. And as the women shared their lives, the manager at Burger King talked about how the owner put her on salary, but kept her running 24 hours a day, and the kids were missing school, and her husband was relapsing, and then the woman on disability with no sight at all left in her eyes took up cursing a blue streak. This woman could curse about the drug dealers in her apartment building. Oh, it was like something just broke loose in me, and the tears just started running down my face. Your suffering was too much for me to hold together with my own. It was too much. My heartbreak started calling out to theirs. The need in me recognized the need in them. And I couldn't hold it anymore. And so I told them. I told them about Ben's mom and about her cancer. And they all sat very still. And they listened very hard. And we prayed together for hope, for healing, and an end to suffering, both ours and all our neighbors. And then we ate a whole lot of bologna sandwiches. A lot. Those women were saints of God. They were. And I know it's true because their compassion opened up a channel for God to work in my life. That's what a saint does. Now, I still felt stretched too tight, but I wasn't trying to fake it anymore. The richness and grace of their prayers restored my soul. And I think Elijah, the woman at Zarephath, would have recognized the spirit at work in us that night. And I believe they would recognize the spirit at work in this congregation today. I believe it because I've seen it myself. There is no doubt, not a jot of doubt in my mind, the Spirit of God is at work in this place, friend, opening up channels for love and life to pour out into our community and into our world. By the power of that Spirit, our homeless assistance team comes together month after month, friend. She sends York Panzer and Jane Hemmen, Lori Dickinson to work, leading a team of dedicated volunteers in faithful service to our neighbors in the margins. And because the Lord our God has promised to sustain us, the Spirit keeps on calling young people with intellectual disabilities into leadership roles as baristas in the Plymouth Grounds coffee shop. And because God calls every one of us beloved child, dozens and dozens of us are moved by the call to serve families with children experiencing homelessness as honored guests right here inside the walls of this church. And friends, it is that same Spirit, that very same Spirit, that moves me to share. Not because I'm swamped with extra hours in the day or dollars in the bank, but talents to meet every need. But because the deep need in me recognizes the deep need in you and in all our neighbors. The longing to be made whole, the grief for our common loss, the hope for healing and new beginning. The deepest hunger we know for meaning, hope, and life that calls us to live so God can use us. Brothers and sisters, beloved of God, the one who formed us in love for the purpose of love is still speaking in this place, calling us to become the channels, become channels for the healing power of love that never fails. I've been hearing that call. I believe you hear it too. So the only question left to ask is, who's in? Answer the call. Let God use your life, your time, your talent, your treasure for something so much bigger than either of us can imagine. By your gifts, be a part of what the Spirit is calling into life. I invite you to give generously to offering this morning and to pledge yourself in deeper commitment to Plymouth Church in 2017.